topics that our adult forum is going to be about today. I hope you'll be able to come. We'll be socially distanced.
Yes, the chairs are set up downstairs. Thank you. All right. Also, there is an insert, both attached on the website and available when you picked up your bulletin. And this is for our entire series in January and February on racism that's built into our social structures and governmental structures. So it has so if you picked it up last week, it's the same one. But it has the do's and don'ts of allyship, and it also has a reimagined world. And so I know that sometimes what we're talking about is going to get a little heavy, and if you need a pick-me-up, just reimagine that world. And there's a lot of ways we can reimagine that world, so that's there for your reference. We're also going to be taking a special offering this morning. We're going to be singing some gospels and some spirituals, and as I'll explain in a moment, spirituals have no composers that are on record, so we don't pay any copyright for that. So the original artists get nothing. And so a number of churches are moving towards paying into a reparation fund, essentially, to make up for that. And so we'll be doing the same thing. So if you want to make a contribution, we don't know yet where it's going to go. We'll start that out. But if you want to make a contribution, you can, if you're writing a check, put spiritual fund on it. And if you're using our PayPal account, which is our electronic option, there's a notes or a comments section. And in the comments, if you put spirituals funds, then we will put that money aside, and as a congregation, we will decide how we're going to distribute it and how we're going to continue to contribute to it. So just be aware we'll be doing that today. Let's see, a few other announcements that are in your bulletin and hopefully in your e-news tomorrow. So today was recorded on Friday. There were some issues with live streaming in the moment, but it has been, now it's been posted. So if you tried to catch it on Friday night and you couldn't, feel free to go back and participate in the Tuesday service. Mini Harvest, our free food giveaway, is this coming Saturday. It will be outside, so please dress appropriately, and it begins at 7 o'clock. And our annual meeting next week will now be on Zoom. So, and we will not be watching the presentation on the future of the denomination, because watching a video on Zoom is complicated and there's a delay and it doesn't work well. So we'll watch the video at some later date, and our meeting will now start at 1. So at 1 o'clock, there will be a link in your e-news tomorrow, and you can participate in our annual meeting at 1 o'clock via that Zoom link for next Sunday. The winter retreat, however, is another weekend beyond that, and we feel like that's far enough away that we're going to keep the schedule as it is for now. We'll let you know next week if there are changes. We'll actually make any last-minute decisions about inside events on Wednesday before the winter retreat, which is happening in-house. All outdoor activities are on, so those are all going to happen. Indoor activities are what's up in the air. So we'll figure that out. We'll let you know, with the exception of the dinner, which is definitely on. And that's our fundraising dinner. You don't have to do anything else for the winter retreat, but you can come and pick up Mastachali, which sounds awesome. Did I say it? Wait, where did it go? Peter's not even here. Look at, did I say it right? All right. So, Mastachali, I've been working on it. All right. Like a Mastachali dinner. It's going to be awesome. And you can make, we do ask that you make reservations for that dinner. A number of you have emailed me. That's awesome. I did get all those. But if you want to make a reservation today in person, Annette Meyer is going to be out in the narthex, and she'll have a reservation sheet and the ability to pay for it electronically. So find Annette and make a reservation for that dinner. It'll be great. And it'll be takeout. So you can just come and pick up your dinner and bring it to wherever it is that you want to eat. All right. I think I covered all the stuff that changed. So, Jefferson, did you want to say something? You're just standing there. Sorry. I assume that, yeah, Ben, you needed to say something.
Hang on.
Yes.
Great. So the reason that you can hear me now, the reason you can always hear these great musicians and singers, is because we have a really nice sound system. What we don't have is enough people to run it. So I'm here today to make a really strong plea for more volunteers in two specific areas. One, if you are somebody who regularly attends the 9 o'clock service and are here on some sort of general basis, at least once a month, maybe twice a month, I need somebody to run the soundboard in the morning. It is seriously as simple as turning on two on buttons and then just adjusting volume. And that's all it takes for the first service. Very, very simple. Anybody can do it. And we desperately need help to have somebody step up and help us with that. The second thing I want to do is see if I can get some people to volunteer to help set up the sound equipment up here, which is just putting cords and plugging in microphones. Again, an easy thing to do. And at the end of the second service, helping to take that equipment down, helping the band break that down. Talking about 15 minutes on both ends of that. So those are two things that we definitely, definitely need going forward. I'm not sure if everybody understands how lucky we were in the past that we had three people who basically did this job for about 15 or 20 years every Sunday. That's something we cannot sustain anymore. I can't do it every Sunday. We've got a limited amount of people who can step in and just immediately do it on the fly. So we really do need to develop more people to help with that. Second service is a little more complicated to do, but again, you can be trained in on doing the basics of that. That's something we'll look at later, but for now, those two areas, 9 o'clock service and set up and break down the band. If you are available to help with that, please reach out to me. My name, my number, and my email are in the church directory, and that's Jefferson Slinger.
Great. Thank you, Jefferson. And if you can't find Jefferson or can't find your directory, just email me. I'll forward it to Jefferson. All right. I think we're done with all the announcements, but you have an announcement. Alright, so take a look at your bulletins and take a look at the key news tomorrow, and we'll have all of that. Alright, so if you would please rise in body or spirit for our call to worship. Rejoice! We live sustained by God's presence and love.
Thanks be to God.
As we mourn the wounds of God's children,
God gives to us.
As we give thanks for all who have lived in faith,
God gives thanks.
As we struggle for justice,
God struggles with us.
As we strive for peace,
God strives with us.
As we work to build the beloved community,
God works with us.
As we offer our gifts to all,
God blesses us.
People of God, rejoice.
Sustained by God's presence and love, we worship God.
All right, you may be seated. You're going to hear a little bit about each of our songs before you get to hum them and the band gets to sing them. Wade in the Water is an African-American spiritual, sometimes just called spirituals. This genre of song comes from enslaved African-Americans. The original composers of these songs are not recorded, and the songs were taught orally, passing from one person to the next. Enslaved Africans were not allowed to sing or make music in the traditions they brought from Africa, but after Christianity was introduced to enslaved African Americans, music with Christian themes was allowed by most enslavers. Enslaved African Americans found the stories of bondage and liberation in the Bible to be fascinating and compelling, and many spirituals reflect these biblical themes. Water was another important image in spirituals. Enslaved peoples had been carried to this country across the ocean. And the Ohio River was the dividing line between slavery and freedom on the Underground Railroad. Luckily, water images are also prominent in the Bible, so composers could combine biblical themes with their own experiences. The refrain of Wade in the Water is based on John 5, verses 2 through 9, It's the story of a pool by one of the gates of Jerusalem. The story goes that an angel is known to come and trouble the water, make waves in it. The first person to enter the pool after the water was troubled would be healed. The first stanza of this hymn also makes a reference to crossing the Red Sea, and the last refers to the Jordan River where Jesus was baptized. While many sermons could be preached out of these themes, some also speculated that the instructions to wade in the water were also very practical. If you wanted freedom, wade in the water so that the dogs will lose your scent. And make sure to cross the Ohio River so you can find freedom in the north. Let us hum Wade in the Water. And paying attention can also help us to see where things in the world need to change. And that change can be really hard, but it is the only way that we can grow as individuals and as a community. So for this morning, I want to share a book with you about change, and I want you to pay attention to the little girl in this book and see how she uses her imagination and her courage to help bring people together in not only noticing change, but in having that imagination and courage to bring change to the community. So this morning, we are going to be reading Change Sings. We'll get it up there so you can all see the illustrations in just a moment. We're very good at being patient. So if you don't recognize the name Amanda Gorman, she is the U.S. Youth Poet Laureate, and she was the poet the poet who read at the inauguration. So Change Things is written by Amanda Gorman. The illustrations are by Lauren Wong, and it's published by Penguin Random House. I can hear change humming in its loudest, proudest song. I don't fear change coming, and so I sing along. I scream with the skies of red and blue streamers. I dream with the cries of tried and true dreamers. I'm a chant that rises and rings. There is hope where my change sings. Though some don't understand it, those windmills of mysteries, I sing with all the planet and its hills of histories. I hum with 100 hearts, each of us lifting a hand. I use my strengths and my smarts, taking me to make a stand. I'm bright as the light each day brings. There is love where my change sings. I show others tolerance, though it might take some courage. I don't make a taller fence, but fight to build a better bridge. I talk not only of distances, from where and how we came. I also walk our differences to show we are the same. I'm a movement that roars and screams. There's a wave where my change sings. Change sings where? There. Inside me, because I'm the change I want to see. As I grow, it grows like seeds. I am just what the world needs. I'm the voice where freedom rings. You're the love your bright heart brings. We are the waves starting to spring, for we are the change we sing. We're what the world is becoming, and we know it won't be long. We all hear change strumming. Won't you sing along? And now, at this point, I invite you to take a moment to pass the peace of Christ to one another. We're still not milling around, so you can stand up as you're able. Look at who are the other people in the room and pass the peace of Christ to one another.
Ensemble to raise money for their debt-ridden Fisk University.
They were wildly successful, and while their repertoire did not originally include spirituals, a few people encouraged them to start including them in their public concerts. The audience loved them, and by the time the tour reached its conclusion 18 months later, they were almost exclusively singing spirituals. African Americans associated spirituals with slavery and with the suffering they were trying to move away from as a free people. The Fisk Jubilee singers were not only credited with saving Fisk University, but also for saving and giving life to spirituals. John Wesley Work Jr. led the Fisk Jubilee singers from 1898 to 1904. And while many different versions existed of what was originally called in some places the Christmas Plantation Song, Wesley Work Jr. adapted the music and the words for this version of Go Tell It on the Mountain that we have in our memories. And so since we're in the season of Epiphany, we get to still sing Christmas songs, and we'll be humming Go Tell It on the Mountain. How proud we are. Home soon after his first heart surgery, Prayers for continued healing for him and for his family as they provide care at home, and prayers for the heart surgeries still in his future. Prayers of thanksgiving for Jim Hicks, who was discharged home from the hospital this week, and continued prayers for management of his heart function and oxygen levels. Prayers for Brenda Desmond, who's the mother of Ben Kappelman. She continues to be hospitalized for seizures that are happening as a result of her brain cancer. Prayers for strength and wisdom for Ben and his extended family, and for healing for Brenda. As many of you are aware, hospitals are now closing down their visitation, and so the inability of the family to visit her now in the second week of her hospitalization is really tough. They're hoping that she is able to come home soon, and at the very least be able to go to transitional care where they might be able to do some more visiting. Prayers for the families and friends of those impacted by the fire in the apartment building in New York City that killed 17 people and injured many others and left a number of families without a home. And prayers for all the people at the Beth Israel Synagogue in Colleyville, Texas, where a gunman took four members of the congregation hostage yesterday for many hours. Prayers for them and for that community for healing. And prayers for the people in the island nation of Tonga. There was an underwater volcanic eruption yesterday that covered the country with a cloud of ash, and then there was a tsunami. With almost no communication possible there, we don't know what is happening. So prayers for all the people in that on that island and for all who are working for the safety and well-being of one another. And so holding all these things and many others in our hearts, let us join our voices together in our morning prayer. Eternal God, lover of our souls, we come to you this morning hungering for something from you that will change the rest of our lives. We come hungering for honesty instead of corruption, for generosity instead of greed. We come hungering for integrity instead of intrigue. We come hungering for our neighbors to be fed and for all to have enough work to provide the basic needs of their families. We come this morning hungering for righteousness to flow like rain and water, and for justice like an ever-flowing stream described by the prophets. We come hungry, and we come listening for your words to us, describing how we can participate in your great works of your creation. We come listening for ways that we can become part of the solution and not part of the problem. We come listening in fear and trembling, praying that we will have the courage to respond and act if we hear a clear word of instruction from you. Speak, Lord, for your children are listening. Let us now be in a time of silent prayer. God, Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. prayed this prayer over 60 years ago, and we offer it again today from our own hearts. Most gracious and all-wise God, before whose face the generations rise and fall, thou in whom we live and move and have our being, we thank you for all your good and gracious gifts, for life and for health, for food and for raiment, for the beauties of nature, the love of human nature. We come before you painfully aware of our inadequacies and shortcomings. We realize that we stand surrounded with the mountains of love, and we deliberately dwell in the valley of hate. We stand amid the forces of truth and deliberately lie. We are forever offered the high road, and yet we choose to travel the low road. For these sins, O God, forgive us. Break the spell of that which blinds our minds. Purify our hearts, that we may see thee. O God, in these turbulent days, when fear and doubt are mounting high, give us broad visions, penetrating eyes, and the power of endurance. Help us to work with renewed vigor for a warless world, for a better distribution of wealth, and for a community that transcends race or color. Hear us now as we gather all of our prayers together in the name of the Christ who taught us to pray, our Creator, God in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Few chapters in the Bible resonated with the souls of enslaved peoples as much as Jeremiah 8 did. Israel is in exile. The Babylonians are preparing to violate their holy places for treasure and to dishonor their dead. The Israelites wonder what they have done to deserve this. The chapter ends with three plaintive rhetorical questions. Is there no balm in Gilead? Is there no physician there? Why then is not the health of the daughter of my people recovered? The refrain of "there is a balm in Gilead" offers encouragement and dares to respond with hope in the face of hopelessness. The original composer takes the question mark in Jeremiah's sentence and changes it to an exclamation point. There is a balm in Gilead. The theme does not seem to be about physical or emotional healing. The great theologian Howard Thurman suggests that the message for today in this hymn extends beyond the individual to a hope for healing in the experience of all humanity. So let us hum. There is a balm in Gilead.
Oh,
Amos, chapter 5, verses 23 and 24. Take away from me the noise of your songs. I will not listen to the melody of your harps, but let justice roll down like waters, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. The word of God for the people of God. Most people know that Precious Lord, Take My Hand was written by jazz musician Thomas Dorsey in 1932, following the death of his wife and infant son. Here is his account of what happened. Back in 1932, I was 32 years old and a fairly new husband. My wife, Betty, and I were living in a little apartment on Chicago's south side. One hot August afternoon, I had to go to St. Louis, where I was to be the featured soloist at a large revival meeting. I didn't want to go. Nettie was in the last month of pregnancy with our first child. But a lot of people were expecting me in St. Louis. In the steaming St. Louis heat, the crowd called on me to sing again and again. When I finally sat down, a messenger boy ran out of the Western Union telegram. I ripped open the envelope, pasted on the yellow sheet were the words, "Your wife just died." When I got back, I learned that Nettie had given birth to a boy. I swung between grief and joy, yet that night, the baby died. I buried Nettie and our little boy together in the same casket. Then I fell apart. For days, I closeted myself. I felt that God had done me an injustice, and I didn't want to serve God anymore or write God's song. I just wanted to go back to that jazz world I once knew so well. Still, I was lost in grief. Everyone was kind to me, especially a friend, Professor Fry, who seemed to know what I needed. On the following Saturday evening, he took me up to Malone's Morrill College, a neighborhood music school. It was quiet. The late evening sun crept through the curtain windows. I sat down at the piano, and my hands began to browse the keys. Dorsey was choir director for Pilgrim Baptist Church in Chicago. He gave the piece he composed that day in the music school to his friend Fry, who introduced it the very next Sunday at Atlanta's Ebenezer Baptist Church. The hymn tore up the church and made a significant impression on their new minister, Martin Luther King Jr.
Today we're going to be singing Arrangement of Precious Lord that was written by Lord Ringwald and was specifically written in memory of Martin Luther King Jr.
Oh,
So we continue with our worship by taking our morning offering. And I invite you to be as generous as you can with your entire body. And if you are able to support the music and mission of Minnehaha, we invite you to do so. And also keep in mind that we are inviting a special contribution today for spirituals reparation. So you can put spirituals fund on your check or on the comment line of your electronic donation, and we will find a place that we will make those donations. Thanks.
Maybe you can go to the ground.
done a bang-up job this morning, but you may have noticed that we're a musician short. Yesterday, Josh Espinoza found out that there was a close exposure to COVID in his household, and so he has to quarantine, which meant that all of you then had to figure out what to do differently. And I imagine, Anders, that's why you're racing back and forth between the chart and morning. So, thank you for doing that. Thank you all for being flexible and adaptable, and thank you for such amazing music this morning. We really appreciate it. James Weldon Johnson had a versatile career as a writer, teacher, diplomat, and lawyer. He was actually the first African-American to pass the bar in the state of Florida in 1898. In 1900, early in his career, Johnson was asked to speak to a high school in his hometown of Jacksonville, Florida, for an observance celebrating the birth of Abraham Lincoln. Rather than make a speech, he decided he would write a poem. And as the time drew near, his plans changed from writing a poem to composing a song. He turned to his brother, J. Rosamond Johnson, to compose music for his text. The two brothers, over their careers, wrote over 200 songs, mostly for stage. But they wrote this one. The composition was a hit, and even though the Johnsons' New York publisher chose not to actively promote the song, children throughout the South sang it, keeping it alive. Among many positions he held, James Johnson served as the executive secretary for the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People from 1920 to 1930, and Lift Every Voice and Sing became known as the African-American National Anthem. So please rise in body or spirit for the coming of Lift Every Voice and Sing.
Thank you.
now go forth, accepting the ministry to which each one of us is surely called, rejoicing in the blessings of our Creator God, continually renewed in the life of Jesus Christ, and hoping in the presence of the Spirit to go in peace and be led out in joy. Amen.